Now let's talk about some more important issues when recording transactions. The first thing we'll do in this video is change the view of the register. Right now, when we look at the register, we see it's 1-2 lines for every one transaction. 2 lines for check number 1 and all the information, 2 lines for check number 2, and so on. It would be much easier to see and understand if it were just 1 line per transaction, where you had columns and rows and different fields that you could see. In my opinion, all of the students who are following along with us should move to the bottom left of the register window and click the check mark where it says 1 line. If you remove the check mark, it goes back to 2 lines for each transaction. If you click the check mark, it turns every transaction into 1 line instead of 2. The same fields of information are there. You still have the date, the document number, the name of the person, the name of the general ledger account that represents the reason for the transaction. And of course, these 2 columns still show the money amount. And of course, we still have over here the running balance. So let's leave our register window with 1 line instead of 2, because this is an introductory class and you want to see your transactions as clearly as possible. Now let's enter 3 more transactions. Let's see if we can predict the results in the trial balance before we record them. For example, January 4 deposited $7,000 into the bank from the register of January 4, which totaled $7,000. Well, let's think about what will change. We have $7,000 more in income, so the daily cash sales will increase to $17,000. If we make a deposit of $7,000, we have $7,000 more in the bank, so cash in bank will increase to $16,000. Let's record this deposit the same way we recorded the previous one. First, we go back, we put the date. Remember, click on the calendar box, then the back arrow to bring the date to the month that we're recording transactions in, and choose the day. QuickBooks thinks this is number 3, but it's actually 0002, which is the number on the source document. For a cash deposit, there is no payee, and we can leave this field blank. But the account tells us the reason for the transaction. When we click the pull down arrow, we get the entire list of the chart of accounts that we put in when we set up the file. We're recording income. We're recording this deposit is happening because we have income into the cash register of $7,000. You must be very careful to make sure that you put the money only in the deposit column. When you push the tab key, you'll get this message about past transaction. Click yes to pass the message or any other message that might come up. And notice, after we recorded this, QuickBooks says the ending balance in the bank account is $16,000, which agrees here with the trial balance, and the total income earned by the company is $17,000. Now let's record the next check. Imagine January 5. Paid UPS $900 for delivery, and that's check number 3. So if we pay $900 from the bank account will decrease and become $15,100. After we record our first delivery check, delivery expense will show up on the trial balance for $900. We put the date January 5th. QuickBooks suggests check number 3. And in this case, we agree. This is to UPS. And the reason we're paying UPS, the account that we put is delivery expense. Make sure you put the checks in the payment column, push the tab key, and then when you click record, you get this message that we will just click yes for that will be explained later. Cash in bank goes down to $15,100, and of course delivery expense shows up for the first time on the trial balance as $900. Let's predict the results after this one. January 6th, paid Verizon $800 for telephone using check number 4. Well, We know telephone expense will show up in the trial balance for the first time as $800. And if we pay another $800 from the cash in bank, it should go down to $14,300. Let's take a look once again. Check number four, January 6th, Verizon $800. So January 6th, check number four, Verizon. Telephone expense, because that's the reason we paid Verizon. Put 800 in the field and push tab. When we record, click yes to pass this message. 14,300 is the cash in bank. And telephone expense shows up on the trial balance for the first time as $800. Now, you will notice something interesting happens when you record a second transaction with the same vendor. The results in the trial balance will change the same way and will be easy to predict. For example, January 7 pays Con Edison $700 for electricity. Check number 5. Okay, let's record that. So that's check number 5, January 7th. But look closely what happens when we choose Con Edison. Aha! QuickBooks remembers that Con Edison goes with electric expense, that this vendor is associated with this general ledger account from the previous transaction. That's why it remembered to put electric expense when we chose Con Edison. The money amount is $700 and we push tab. When we record, click yes. Cash goes down to $13,600 and you notice electric expense has increased from $500 that it was a moment ago to $1,200. Let's take a look at the next one. Paid Verizon $600 for telephone. Well, right now telephone expense is $800. But if we pay $600 more for telephone, telephone will become $1,400. And if we pay $600, cash and bank will go down to $13,000 even. So, this is January 8th, check number 6. Look what happens when we choose Verizon. Aha! Telephone expense comes up because QuickBooks remembers the previous Verizon transaction where we chose telephone. In this case, the money amount is $600. When we record a payment of $600, $13,000 even is our bank account. And you can see telephone expense has increased to $1,400. QuickBooks gives you the ability to add accounts and vendors and other list items on the fly. What does this expression mean, on the fly? It means that you can add accounts or vendors at the moment you enter a transaction. You do not have to close the register window and reopen the list windows that we learned about earlier. You can enter them directly at the moment you make the transaction. For example, let us imagine on January 9th, we paid Joe's Distributors $1,000 for products that we will later sell for customers. And this will be check number 7. Well, Joe's Distributor is not on our vendor list, but we can add his name to the vendor list at the moment we record the transaction. You might also notice that we have no expense account for the products that we sell at the minute that we pay and buy these products. The new account that we will add at the moment we record this transaction will be called product expense. And when it shows up on the trial balance, it will represent the total money that we have paid for products and merchandise that we will later sell to the customer. Let's take a look how to record this transaction. So here we are again in the register window. Make sure you choose the date, January 9, check number 7. Now Joe's Distributor is not on the list. What we can do is we can click this Add New button, and it will ask us what type of name we're adding, because in the future we will learn about customers and employees. Leave the default as vendor, and all you have to do is type in his name, Joe's Distributors. That's it. You could always go back to the, let's put it in capitals, but you could always go back to the vendor center that we learned before and add information such as his address and other kind of settings. For now, we'll just add the name so we can record the transaction. Now we have to put the account or the reason for this check as product expense. When we click the account button, we see there is no product expense in the list of the chart of accounts right now. No problem. We can click Add New, and of course the type of account is already chosen as expense. QuickBooks knows if you're adding an account from the register that probably the type of account is expense. Make sure cap locks is on and type product expense. When we click save and close, we now have filled out the field with the right amount. Of course, this is a payment for $1,000. And now we will click record. Click yes to pass this message. When we bring the trial balance forward, we can see that cash and bank has gone down to $12,000, but for the very first time, product expense is now in the trial balance as $1,000. If we open the vendor center, I'm going to move it over a little, we can see Joe's distributor has been added to the vendor list at the moment that we made the transaction. We will end this video by showing you how you can see the transactions listed in the general ledger accounts. The trial balance is just a summary. It shows you only the total balance of each account in the general ledger. If you want to see the details, you have to open up each general ledger account and see how the transactions are listed one by one. Here's the trial balance. Let's take a look at an example. Let's take a look at repair expense. Actually, no. Let's take a look at electric expense. We know we have more than one transaction recorded in the account electric expense. The total is $1,200. When we double click, we can see a window opens up that shows us the detail. So let's close it out and take a look. The total summary of the electric expense ledger account is $1,200. When we double click, we'll bring it into view. When we double click, we see each individual transaction that was recorded in electric expense listed here one by one. If you remember, the check we wrote on January 3rd was for electricity, and the check we wrote on January 7 was for electricity. Let's remind you. Let's take a look at the register window here. January 3rd, this was a check for electricity, $500. That's what's listed here in the account. QuickBooks posted it to this account, electric expense. Same thing with January 7. Here's the January 7 transaction. Also Con Edison, check number 5, $700 of electricity. Take a look, January 7th, check number 5. When you recorded it here, QuickBooks posted it here. Now notice each ledger account has its own running balance. So you see the balance was $500 after check number 2, and then the balance increased to become $1,200 after check number 5. That's also true with the other account that had another transaction. The other account that we had two transactions with was telephone expense. So if we open up our trial balance, because I accidentally closed it, remember A on your keyboard for all, we can see telephone expense is $1,400. If we want to know why that is the balance, we double click and open up the actual ledger account called telephone expense. Notice it lists check number 4 and check number 6 for their proper amounts, because if we look at the register, we see check number 4 was for telephone $800 and check number 6 was for telephone $600. When we recorded these, QuickBooks automatically posted them into the general ledger account telephone expense. And each time it posted a transaction to this account, the balance went up. And that explains why the total balance is $1,400 in the trial balance for telephone expense.